Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all to today's ICANN initiative, the Hindu and Indian Express analysis. We'll start today's class with a very interesting story of a Chinese emperor. There was a Chinese emperor who had a very huge kingdom, but then he had no children. So he wanted to select a heir for his kingdom. He invited all the children who were a part of his kingdom to his palace. He gave all these children one seed, and then he asked them to plant those seeds in the pot and then return to the emperor after 1 year. So children took the seeds with them. They took a pot, they soiled, and then they planted the seed. And they also regularly watered it. But after the end of 1 year, when all the children came with their pots back to the palace of the emperor. So some of them had grown flowering plants, some of them had shrubs in their pots, some of them even had trees out of their pots. But there was one person called as Ling, whose pot was barren. Ling was very prompt. He had put a seed in the pot and he has watered it every single day without fail, but still he couldn't grow anything in the pot. So the emperor examined all the pots and then he finally says that the seed that he had given on the day 1 year before has been boiled until that it was no longer viable and it wouldn't grow any vegetation. But he saw thousands of plants and then only there was one barren pot. He says that integrity and courage are more important values for leadership than proud displays. So he announces Ling to be his heir. So here what quality Ling is showing is integrity. Integrity means doing the right thing even when nobody is watching you doing that. In this case, nobody was seeing. Ling could have easily swapped the seeds and then he could have grown a different seed and he could have gotten flowers. But what he did, that he did the right thing. He planted the seed that was given by the emperor only. And then he watered it promptly every day as told by the emperor. But what the other kids did was to change the seed into a different seed so that they could grow very luxurious vegetation in the pot and they could impress the emperor. But emperor clearly says that these proud displays do nothing. Rather, integrity and courage are important values for leadership. So with this story, we will start today's analysis. The first article is about the interstate relations. So the story behind this goes like this. This highway that connects Kasaragod in Kerala and Mangalore in Karnataka has been blocked. So Kerala took this even to the court because several patients in Kasaragod, there is a huge disease burden there, and then they access medical facilities in Mangalore. So what the Kerala government wanted was that Karnataka should open its borders. But Karnataka government says that if it opens its borders, there is a very high likelihood that the corona cases from Kasaragod could spill over to Karnataka as well. So the interesting case and thing in this story is that interstate migration and quarantine are under the union list. But the prevention of infectious diseases from spreading from one state to another is in the concurrent list in which even the states have a say. So using this power, Karnataka government is saying that it has all the powers to impose restrictions on the border and to prevent the spillover of coronavirus into its boundaries. So this has resulted into a sort of interstate tussle. Whenever we talk of interstate relations, there are basically four major dimensions, especially the constitutional dimensions that we talk about. The first thing is the interstate water disputes. The second thing is about the interstate councils, the efficacy of the interstate councils. The third is about the mutual recognition of public acts, records, and judicial proceedings. And the fourth is about trade, commerce in the interstate trade and commerce. So these are the four dimensions we talk about when we talk about the interstate relations as specified in the Constitution. In the case of water disputes, Article 262 of the Constitution says that the Parliament has the power to make law. Parliament can thus make law saying that any dispute between two states regarding any interstate river or river valley can be adjudicated in such and such a manner. So this law can be made by the Parliament. Also, the Parliament can tell that Supreme Court or High Courts will have no jurisdiction over an interstate water dispute. So, by following the powers that has been granted under Article 262, government has enacted the River Boards Act and also the Interstate Water Disputes Act. So, under Interstate Water Disputes Act, the central government can set up ad hoc tribunals for adjudicating disputes between two or more states. Accordingly, we know that several tribunals have been set up, like the Kaveri Water Dispute Tribunal, Krishna Water Dispute Tribunal, Narmada Water Dispute Tribunal, and so on. Next, we come to the Interstate Council. So this has been specified under Article 263 of the Constitution. It says that whenever the President sees that there is a public interest that would be served by establishing an Interstate Council, he can do so. So accordingly, in 1990s, the Interstate Council was first established. It has three main purposes. One is that if there is any dispute arising between the state, this dispute will be inquired into and the Interstate Council will advise the states over such a dispute. The second thing is that if there is any common interest between the states, so the Interstate Council can discuss such common interests between the states so that there is a common welfare. The third important objective of the Interstate Council is that it has to recommend how the policy and policy actions can be coordinated. So coordination of the policy actions and recommendations in this regard is a very important function of the Interstate Council. So the composition of the Interstate Council, as you all know, is the Prime Minister, who is the chairman, and then chief ministers of all the states are present in this. Then even chief ministers of all the union territories where there are legislative assemblies, and administrators of union territories where there are no legislative assemblies. And apart from this, six cabinet ministers, which includes a home minister, and the rest being nominated by the Prime Minister. All of these comprise of the membership of Interstate Council. So when it comes to trade, commerce and intercourse, Article 301 of the Constitution says that trade, commerce throughout the territory of India is going to be free. So any one particular state cannot impose a discriminatory tariff over a product that has been imported from another state compared to the similar product that is being sold within the boundaries of the state. But however, the Constitution has granted the Parliament some powers which says that for public interest, Parliament can formulate some laws which actually restrict this free trade and commerce between the states. While I'm mentioning all these measures, we notice that these are mainly the constitutional measures. But at the same time, we have several statutory and informal measures also for achieving interstate coordination and cooperation. For instance, we have zonal councils, which are statutory. Then we have a chief minister's conference, which is presided over by the Prime Minister. We have governor's conference, which is presided over by the President of India. So all of these also give an additional forum. These days also the governing councils of Niti Aayog, they all give additional fora where the center state and interstate issues could be discussed to ensure cooperative federalism. The next topic that we will discuss today is the India-Pakistan relations. Why this is in news is because Omar Saeed Sheikh has now been accused of kidnapping and killing an American journalist, Daniel Pearl, in Karachi in 2002. So this person was accused in killing the American journalist, and the American journalist was even beheaded by Saeed Sheikh, But now a Sindh special court has acquitted him of this charge of murder, citing that there is lack of evidence to prove this charge. So why is this news important for India? Because Omar Syed Sheikh is involved in several activities in India as well. He was released from an Indian jail after the hijack of the Indian airliner in 1999. And also, he was trying to get Masood Azhar, who is the chief of Jaish-e-Mohammed, released from Indian jail. So, because of this, his release is very important for India also. This reminds us of Pakistan's track record of releasing and freeing all those people who have been involved in terrorist attacks in India. So, what has been the Pakistan's track record? When we see in 2015, Zakir Rahman Lakhvi, who had supervised the 26/11 Mumbai attacks, was also released free. And secondly, the Jaish-e-Mohammed chief, Masood Azhar, India has been wanting to declare him as a global terrorist and blacklist Jaish-e-Mohammed in the international level. But then Pakistan has now conveniently saying that Masood Azhar and his family has gone missing. So they don't want him to get surrendered and they don't want him to be caught. So this shows the willingness of Pakistan time and again, because Pakistan has been providing a safe haven for the terrorist activities. It is acting as a launch pad from where terrorist activities are being carried out on India. It is a safe haven for various organizations like Jaish-e-Mohammed, Jamaat-ud-Dawa, etc. And these organizations operate from the Pakistan soil itself. And they have carried out several terrorist attacks on the Indian soil, be it the 2001 Parliament attack or the 26/11 Mumbai attack, the Uri attack in 2016, and then in 2019 it was the Pulwama attack. So all of these attacks have been carried out by these terrorist outfits, but Pakistan has time and again denied being a safe haven to these organizations, and then it has denied having giving any support to them. So, but however, there are certain quarters of people who believe that there is some kind of a change of attitude when it comes to Pakistan, and this is because of various reasons. The first reason is that Pakistan has already paid a heavy price for its policy of acting as a safe haven for the terrorist organizations. So also, they have realized that using terrorism as a foreign policy tool has not served its interests at all. So this realization is now coming in Pakistan. The second thing is that Pakistan itself has seen several casualties. These organizations have struck in Pakistan itself, and it has led to loss of several civilians' life in Pakistan. So it is now having a realization that what it nurtured is now bleeding itself. So this is a second important reason. The third is that the international community pressure. For instance, the FATF has already blacklisted, it has put Pakistan in the grey list. So Pakistan is now under an international pressure to act decisively against these terrorist organizations. Otherwise, sanctions could be levied on Pakistan. The fourth important reason why there is a feeling that there is a change in the attitude in Pakistan is because it is seen that the financial support to radicalism is decreasing. For instance, the Saudi government had a policy of supporting Wahhabism, but this export of Wahhabism is no longer a foreign policy priority of the Saudi Arabian government. So this is also another reason. The fifth and probably one of the very important reasons is the influence of China. China is building this China-Pakistan economic corridor, and then it wants to ensure that in these regions where this passes through, the Chinese activities and investments are extremely safe and they are outside of any terrorist activities. So it is building pressure on Pakistan to eradicate terrorist activities in those regions so that the Chinese investments are safe. Also, China is suffering the problem of terrorism in its Xinjiang province, and because of this also China is pressurizing Pakistan to ensure that these organizations do not thrive on the Pakistan soil. At the same time, several measures that have been taken at the government level, like opening of the Kartarpur Sahib corridor, and then there is already an economic crisis that is going on in Pakistan. So all of these, the situation of the Pakistan overall is such that it may be bound to change its attitude regarding terrorism in the coming days. The next thing we are going to see is there has been a crash in the oil prices. So in this context, what should be India's strategy? The first thing is that in 2019, the oil prices was at $64 per barrel. But now the price has reduced to $30 per barrel. So this is this has been a precipitous fall in the price of oil. So this is cited because mainly of two reasons. One is that in overproduction. For instance, the Saudi Arabia produced 9.8 million barrels per day before March, and now it is producing 12 million barrels per day. The second reason is that because of COVID, there is a crash in the demand. And this crash in the demand is because the two important consumers of the oil, that is the transportation industry and transportation and the industry, they are under complete lockdown. So because of this, there is a fall in the demand for oil. So therefore, we must actually now itself think about a post-COVID world, and accordingly, we must build our strategy to ensure our energy security. So what the article says is that because of the reasons like the post the COVID and then the demand, fall in the demand, and also because of the overproduction by Saudi Arabia, Russia, so which is leading overall to the fall in the oil prices, all of these is going to create a lot of difficulties to these oil companies. They are unable to cover their costs, so they may be forced to cut their production or completely shut down their operations. Some of these companies may also go bankrupt, or if they manage to survive, they will definitely have a bad balance sheet. So in this context, the $40 billion Ratnagiri refinery, which is planned by the Saudi Arabian Aramco company in UAE, may also face difficulties because the financial health of Aramco may get affected because of all this crisis. At the same time, even the domestic exploration for oil may also see a fall because again, there won't be much of a demand. This is one reason. The second reason is that because of the COVID and then all the social distancing that is making rounds, even after COVID, the behaviors of people might change. So they may not welcome the concept of shared mobility. So because this concept of social distancing, they would carry even then, and they would be more fearful to have shared mobility. And because of all these things, they would also realize the importance of environment, and there could probably be a move towards decarbonization. So because of all these complex set of factors, it is very much possible that the post-COVID oil price, oil production may not be to the extent as it is now. And so in such a situation, what should India do to protect its energy security? The first thing that India should do is to fill up its strategic reserves. So these reserves should be filled up so that we do not depend on the volatile situation after the post-COVID world, in the post-COVID world, regarding from where to import and how much to import. So we better have strategic reserves, particularly at a time when the oil prices are low. The second important thing that we must do is to import LNG. LNG can be imported from Australia, Africa, and United States. So the importance of this is that the good thing about LNG is that first, it is economically competitive also. And second, the LNG supplies will come from Australia, US and Africa. And we don't have to depend on Middle East where there is a lot of volatility happening. And thirdly, once we import LNG, several of our stranded gas-based power plants could also be again kick-started. So, and finally, what the third strategy we must adopt is to have an integrated energy policy. So what do we mean by integrated energy policy is it must not just integrate the coal, crude oil, it must integrate with wind, solar, and also with the other unconventional sources like biogas, geothermal, and all these energies. So we must have an integrated energy policy. And this can happen through collaboration and coordination, the importance of which we have already realized during COVID. All right, the next thing is that because in the recent times, the newspapers mostly carry news regarding the coronavirus crisis, not much of the editorials are important and they are just a repetition of the same things, telling the same things over and over again. But there were, I found was some important data that was scattered here and there in different editorials and articles. So whenever we come across such data, it is very important to make a compilation of all these data. And we must have a data sheet ready before the exam to revise. So I found four such data sets which were I found very important. The first thing was an estimation by the Asian Development Bank. So ADB has made an estimate that the corona epidemic can cost the Indian economy $29.9 billion. And also an industry estimate within the country says that it could cost India nearly 4% of our GDP. The second important thing is that the Food Corporation of India at present has 77 million tons of cereals in stock. But what is required for the PDS or the buffer requirement is only 21 million tons. So which means we have surplus food grains and this is the right time where we could sell these surplus stocks through the public distribution system. The reason being, we are seeing a huge migrant crisis and these migrants have stuck up in other cities apart from their own cities and they may not even have their ration cards. So they are facing a very huge problem of hunger. So in such a situation, when we have these surplus stocks, these should be released and then we should use the surplus to tackle the migrant crisis that we are facing today. The third set of important data was that nearly one-fifth of India's labor force, that is nearly 20% of India's labor force, comprises of internal migrants. And also, according to 2011 census, a quarter of the urban population, that is nearly 25% of the urban population, comprises of migrants only. So this data can be used to analyze the extent and the scope of the problem of migrants in our country. And this, given the migrant crisis that is happening, can be a very probable question in the mains this year, that to analyze the issues faced by the migrants and to suggest a way forward for them. So this could be a very probable question. So this set of data becomes very important. And the next data was regarding the NGOs. So now that the government is cooperating with the NGOs to ensure that the last mile connectivity to the people, to ensure that they get all the food and the essential supplies. So government is collaborating with NGOs. So when it comes to NGOs, 67,000 NGOs have registered with Niti Aayog on the NGO Darpan platform. So why they got registered? First of all, it is claimed that there are more than a million NGOs, but then only 67,000 of them have registered. But why was this initiative to register on the Niti Aayog's Darpan platform was made? Because with this registration, what all funds the NGO is receiving, whether from the domestic source or from a foreign source, and what these funds for what activities they were used, all of these will be tracked. So this will foster more transparency, efficiency, and accountability, because there have been issues like the NGOs receiving foreign funding and they having some foreign agenda of their working in India. So this is about the NGO registration and this helps in better accountability and transparency. So next we come to the yesterday's question. Yesterday I had asked a question to analyze the application of robotics in different fields in the Indian economy. So whenever you get such a question, the first thing to do is to have a basic understanding or a definition of robotics. That should be made clear. So what robotics is, that it is just a computer programmable machine. And this machine will be capable of carrying out some tasks which are maybe very complex. And these tasks can be carried by the machine automatically. So this is robotics. So computer programmable machine which can carry out some complex tasks automatically. So this is robotics. So whenever you are asked applications of robotics, give a very wide interpretation to the application. And then think of different sectors possible. It could be industry, it could be agriculture, health, education, or even women, or even military, space. So think of various such fields where the applications you can think of. And then you have to try to elaborate each of these with some examples. Let us take a few examples. For example, in industry. When you come to industry, several of these car manufacturing firms, in the assembly line, they are using robots. So all the spare parts, all the parts are ready, kept ready. But in the assembly line, the assembly is done by the robots. So it is very quick and also it is perfect. At the same time, painting of the bikes and cars. So this requires extreme precision, and this again is done by the robots as well. Even in these electrical and electronics industries where several circuits have to be formed, that again requires a lot of precision, and this may again be done by robots. So next you can think of another field like agriculture. In agriculture, mainly sowing of seeds, planting the seeds can be done by robots, harvesting, weeding, so all of these. So in all these cases, the robots can easily replace the human labor. Even spraying of the insecticides can be done by robotics. For example, yesterday we saw how drones were being used to spray pesticides and fertilizers over the agricultural fields. So all here the robotics application, well, you can find. So next, for example, let's say health. In health, for instance, in Japan, there are several robots who are performing these complicated surgeries where a lot of precision is required. One neuron here and there, it will cost the life of a person. So where such precision and such technicality, complexity is required, so they are done by robots. So yesterday itself, we saw an example of Stanley Medical Hospital in Tamil Nadu, where they are using what is called as a robot nurse. This robot nurse will provide assistance to the COVID patients. This is done to minimize the exposure of the healthcare workers to the COVID positive patients. So next you can think of education, where you have teaching, where the robots are teaching the students and they are demonstrating several things to the students. So this will enable the students to grasp quickly and also helps in their retaining the concept. And then when it comes to finance, in finance also, in the banking industry, so several of the inquiries and all can be done through the robots. And then when it comes to space, for example, these rovers and all the exploration related equipments, they could be robots. Then when you come to military, even there are autonomous weapons where that can trigger some that can trigger a response when some condition is satisfied. So these are autonomous weapons are there which can attack the enemy automatically. Then there are some robots for search and rescue operations also. Even our DRDO has a robot that's called as Daksh. So in all these cases, the robots can be used. So basically how you have to approach the question is to start by giving a basic understanding of what you understand by robotics, and then think of as many different fields as possible, and then try to elaborate how robotics will find an application in each of these fields. So Today's question is, critically examine the relevance of interstate counsel in maintaining friendly interstate relations. So I hope you are all writing some answers each day, because that is very important. Prelims is an exam where you are just in or out, but then ultimately, even if you top prelims, but if you're not prepared for mains, your name will not be there in the merit list, and in which case you will again have to start preparing for prelims next year. So do try to do at least give spare 1 hour a day for mains, even though you will be facing time constraints. So I hope you'll be able to do it. That's for today. Thank you.